In the back of the car, I leaf through book one of the Tess first edition, looking for a quote, and at the same time wonder when Anna's last exam will take place. I read the book years ago and have a hazy recollection of the plot. Fiction was my sanctuary when I was a teenager. My mother always marveled that I read, Eliot not so much. I craved the escape that fiction provided. He didn't need an escape. Mr. Gray, Taylor interrupts. We're here, sir. He climbs out of the car and opens my door. I'll be outside at 2 o'clock to take you to your golf game. I nod and head into Gray House, the books tucked under my arm. The young receptionist greets me with a flirtatious wave. Every day, like a cheesy tune on repeat. Ignoring her, I make my way to the elevator that will take me straight to my floor. Good morning, Mr. Gray. Barry on security greets me as he presses the button to summon the elevator. How's your son, Barry?
Better, sir.
I'm glad to hear it. I step into the elevator and it shoots up to the 20th floor. Andrea is on hand to greet me.
Good morning, Mr. Gray. Roz wants to see you to discuss the Darfur project. Barney would like a few minutes.
I hold my hand up to silence her. Forget those for now. Get me Welch on the line and find out when Flynn is back from vacation. Once I've spoken to Welch, we can pick up the day's schedule.
Yes, sir.
And I need a double espresso. Get Olivia to make it for me. But looking around, I notice that Olivia is absent. It's a relief. The girl is always mooning over me, and it's fucking irritating.
Would you like milk, sir?
Andrea asks. Good girl. I give her a smile. Not today. I do like to keep them guessing how I take my coffee.
Very good, Mr. Gray.
She looks pleased with herself, which she should be. She's the best PA I've had. 3 minutes later, she has Welch on the line.
Welch? Mr. Gray.
The background check you did for me last week. Anastasia Steele, studying at WSU.
Yes, sir, I remember.
I'd like you to find out when her last final exam takes place, and let me know as a matter of priority.
Very good, sir. Anything else?
No, that will be all. I hang up and stare at the books on my desk. I need to find a quote. Roz, my number two and my chief operating officer, is in full flow. We're getting clearance from the Sudanese authorities to put the shipments into Port Sudan, but our contacts on the ground are hesitant about the road journey to Darfur. They're doing a risk assessment to see how viable it is. Logistics must be tough. Her normal sunny disposition is absent. We could always airdrop.
Christian, the expense of an airdrop.
I know. Let's see what our NGO friends come back with.
Okay,
she says and sighs.
I'm also waiting for the all clear from the State Department.
I roll my eyes. Fucking red tape. If we have to grease some palms or get Senator Blandino to intervene, let me know.
So the next topic is where to site the new plant. You know the tax breaks in Detroit are huge. I sent you a summary.
I know. But God, doesn't have to be Detroit.
I don't know what you have against the place. It meets our criteria.
Okay. Get Bill to check out potential brownfield sites, and let's do one more site search to see if any other municipality would offer more favorable terms.
Bill has already sent Ruth out there to meet with the Detroit Brownfield Redevelopment Authority, who couldn't be more accommodating. But I'll ask Bill to do a final check.
My phone buzzes. Yes, I growl at Andrea. She knows I hate being interrupted in a meeting.
I have Welch for you.
My watch says 11:30. That was quick. Put him through. I signal for Roz to stay.
Mr. Gray?
Welch, what news?
Miss Steele's last exam is tomorrow, May 20th.
Damn, I don't have long.
Great, that's all I need to know. I hang up.
Roz, bear with me one moment. I pick up the phone. Andrea answers immediately.
Andrea, I need a blank note card to write a message within the next hour, I say, and hang up.
Right. Roz, where were we?
At 12:30, Olivia shuffles into my office with lunch. She's a tall, willowy girl with a pretty face. Sadly, it's always misdirected at me with longing. She's carrying a tray with what I hope is something edible. After a busy morning, I'm starving. She trembles as she puts it on my desk. Tuna salad. Okay. She hasn't fucked this up for once. She also places three different white cards, all different sizes, with corresponding envelopes on my desk.
Great.
I mutter.
Now go.
She scuttles out. I take one bite of tuna to assuage my hunger, then reach for my pen. I've chosen a quote. A warning. I made the correct choice, walking away from her. Not all men are romantic heroes. I'll take the word menfolk out. She'll understand. Why didn't you tell me there was danger? Why didn't you warn me? Ladies know what to guard against because they read novels that tell them of these tricks. I slip the card into the envelope provided and on it write Anna's address, which is ingrained in my memory from Welch's background check. I buzz Andrea.
Yes, Mr. Gray.
Can you come in, please?
Yes, sir.
She appears at my door a moment later.
Mr. Gray?
Try, baby, try to trust in my love again.
Mr. Gray?
Take these, package them, and courier them to Anastasia Steele, the girl who interviewed me last week. Here's her address.
Right away, Mr. Gray.
They have to arrive by tomorrow at the latest.
Yes, sir. Will that be all?
No. Find me a set of replacements.
For these books?
Yes, first editions. Get Olivia on it.
What books are these?
Tess of the D'Urbervilles.
Yes, sir.
She gives me a rare smile and leaves my office.
Why is she smiling?
She never smiles. Dismissing the thought, I wonder if that will be the last I see of the books. And I have to acknowledge that deep down, I hope not.